MedCram.
Okay, so welcome to Medical Acid Base Part 7. We're going to go over some more questions. And let's just start off with the next question, which in this case is pH is equal to 7.25, 27, 99, and a bicarb of 12. And the chem 7 shows a sodium of 140, a potassium of 4.0, a chloride of 96, and a bicarb of 12. So the first step again is to do the anion gap. And what's the anion gap? So we add these two together and subtract from 140. So 96 plus 12 is 108. 108 from 140 is equal to 32. Definitely anion gap. We now know immediately that we have an anion gap metabolic acidosis. And remember, the mnemonic for that is mud piles. M for methanol, U for uremia, D for diabetic ketoacidosis, but also alcoholic ketoacidosis, and also starvation ketoacidosis. The P is peraldehyde, I is isoniazid or iron, L is lactic acidosis, E is ethylene glycol or ethanol, and S is salicylates. And the S could also stand for starvation ketosis as well if you wanted. Okay, so the anion gap is 32, which is a pretty sizable anion gap. So what we need to do next is calculate the delta gap. And the delta gap is simply telling you above and beyond 12 how much anion gap is there. How strong is this anion gap metabolic acidosis essentially? So that's simply 32 minus 12, which is equal to 20. What does that mean? What does that 20 mean? That means there's 20 units of conjugate base or conjugate anions floating around in the blood that's not accounted for here in the chem 7. And those 20 negatively charged particles have to be balanced out with the bicarb that was missing. So essentially, 20 units of bicarb had to be taken away when they bound to the proton that came off of these 20 units. In other words, what we could say is if we took away the effect of this anion gap metabolic acidosis and just took it away and see what else was there, we could add 20 to the bicarb and see what the bicarb would have been. In this case, 20 plus 12 would have given us a bicarb of 32. What does that tell us? That means if we take away the known anion gap metabolic acidosis, which we already know is there, what would the bicarb be? Well, the bicarb would be 32. And if the bicarb's 32, well, let's just write it down. We already know we have an anion gap metabolic acidosis. We know we've got that, okay? But if we were to take that effect away, since we know the delta gap is 20, we know that that 20 sucked away 20 units of bicarb. Let's add back those 20 units of bicarb to the 12 that we have currently and see what life would be like if we didn't have that anion gap metabolic acidosis. What that would mean is our bicarb would be 32. And if our bicarb is 32, that would mean that we also have a concomitant metabolic alkalosis. That could be like vomiting or Cushing's disease or contraction alkalosis or something like that. So just by doing that, we've already seen that we've identified two different metabolic processes that are occurring. Okay? So we know that. So what's the next step? Next step, as we've gone through, is to look at the pH and the pCO2. Well, we already know that both are going down, and we already have metabolic processes going. So that's easy. We know that already. The next thing is to check to see whether or not Winter's formula holds. So obviously here, we've got a metabolic acidosis and a metabolic alkalosis. Which one do you think is stronger? Well, obviously the metabolic acidosis, or in this case, the anion gap metabolic acidosis is stronger because we're acidotic. We're actually acidemic, okay? So what we need to do is follow Winter's formula for a metabolic acidosis. And what does that say? That says that for every drop in the bicarb of 1, you should also get a drop in the pCO2 of 1. And let's see if that's the case. In our example here, how much did our bicarb drop by? Our bicarb went from 40 down to 12. How much of a drop is that? It's about 28. Actually, it's not from 40 down to 12. It's actually from 24 down to 12. That's the normal. So if we went from 24 down to 12, that's a drop of 12. How much did our pCO2 go down by? It went from 40 down to 27. 40 down to 27 is a drop of 13. And so what we see here is that Winter's formula is followed perfectly for a metabolic acidosis. Okay, now let's just say for some reason that the pCO2 had dropped more. Let's say it had dropped 20 points, for instance. That would mean that instead of dropping just 13 points, which it should have done if there was a pure metabolic acidosis occurring or metabolic problem, if it had dropped by 20 points, that means there would be an increased drop of the pCO2, which would tell us that there must be an additional respiratory alkalosis occurring, and that would be an additional diagnosis that we could put here. Conversely, if the pCO2 had not dropped by 13, but it only dropped by 5, that would mean that there must be a respiratory acidosis occurring because the pCO2 did not drop by the same amount that it should have, as predicted by Winter's formula. So basically, when you're doing this Winter's formula, you're seeing if the pCO2 drop is appropriate. If it's less than appropriate, there's an additional respiratory acidosis. If there's an additional drop than what should be predicted by Winter's formula, then there's a respiratory alkalosis. Since in this case it fits Winter's formula pretty well, then there's no additional respiratory component. And what we've done is we've diagnosed what's happened: an anion gap metabolic acidosis and a metabolic alkalosis. Okay, next question. pH is equal to 7.25, 27, 99, 12. Chem 7, sodium 140 over 4.0, chloride is 118, and the bicarb is 12. First step, calculate the anion gap. 118 plus 12 is equal to 130. 130 from 140 is equal to 10. That means there's no anion gap metabolic acidosis. Step number 2, go ahead and look at the pH and the pCO2. Are they going in the same direction or in opposite directions? In fact, they're going in the same direction, and they're both going down. Therefore, it's a metabolic process, and it's a metabolic acidosis because the pH is low. Therefore, there must be something pushing it down. So it's a metabolic acidosis. The question is there an additional respiratory component? And for that, again, we need to look at our Winter's formula. And that simply states that the drop in the pCO2 and the bicarb must be very similar. Again, so if we have a drop in the HCO3 minus and the pCO2, that's a drop of 1:1. Let's see if that occurred here. So how much of a drop in bicarb did we have? Again, 24 is the normal number, and it dropped from 24 down to 12. So therefore, we had a drop in 12 points. Here, we went from 40 down to 27. That's a drop of about 13. Again, Winter's formula for metabolic acidosis predicts that the pCO2 went down exactly as it should have to compensate, and therefore there is no other respiratory component. Remember, if the pCO2 had gone down even more than what was predicted by Winter's formula, that would be an additional respiratory alkalosis. if the PCO2 went down, but went down by less than predicted, so let's say it only went down by 5 points instead of 13, then that would be a respiratory acidosis in addition to the metabolic acidosis. Next question, pH is equal to 7.50, 48, 90, bicarb 38, chem 7, sodium is equal to 135, potassium is 3.6, chloride is 85, and as we mentioned, bicarb is 38. First step, measure anion gap. 85 plus 38 is 123. 123 from 135 is 12. So the anion gap is equal to 12. The delta gap is 0. We do not have an anion gap metabolic acidosis. Step number 2, look at the pH and the PCO2. And see what the direction is. Here we have a pH going up. Here we have a PCO2 going up. So it must be a metabolic problem. And since they're both going up, it must be an alkalosis. Question, let's do Winter's formula. Again, for every increase in the HCO3 and an increase in the PCO2, there's a 2-to-1 ratio in a metabolic alkalosis. Let's see if that holds up here. How much did our bicarb go up by? 24 is the normal number. Therefore, it went up by 14 points. How much did our CO2 go up by? It went up by 8 points. Is that ratio pretty consistent? I would say so. Remember now, if the PCO2 went up by more than 8 points, then I would say there is a concomitant respiratory acidosis. If it went up by less than 8 points, then I would say there's a concomitant respiratory alkalosis. But in this case, it looks like it's about the same. Therefore, we can say this is a pure metabolic alkalosis. Okay, next question. pH is equal to 7.15, 40, 55, and a bicarb of 15. Here we have our chem 7. Sodium is 140. Potassium, 4.0, chloride, 98, bicarb is 15. First step, calculate anion gap. 98 plus 15 is 113. 113 to 40, anion gap is 27. That's elevated, okay? So the delta gap must be 27 minus 12. Which is 15. We know right off the bat that we have an anion gap metabolic acidosis. Okay, so mud piles again, M-U-D-P-I-L-E-S, must be one of those. And what do we know? We know that there are 15 units of the conjugate base or the negative charge hanging around that protons were released. Those protons were bound to bicarbonate, which we lost. We lost that bicarbonate. And so if we could just wave our magic wand and say, if we were to eliminate this anion gap metabolic acidosis, what would our bicarb be? And we simply add this anion gap to our current bicarb level and we get 30. That's what would it be? And if we saw a bicarb level of 30, we would say that means there must be a metabolic alkalosis occurring at the same time. So we have two different processes occurring at the same time. So let's look at our pH and our PCO2. Okay, remember we do that next. pH, PCO2. Obviously we're dealing with a metabolic acidosis, so it's going to be low. And we look at our pH. The question now is, Since we have a metabolic acidosis and a metabolic alkalosis, the question is which one is stronger? We need to know which one is stronger because we need to know which Winter's formula to use. Do we use the metabolic acidosis Winter's formula, or do we use the metabolic alkalosis Winter's formula? And we see here that the metabolic acidosis must be the stronger of the two, so we'll use the metabolic acidosis Winter's formula, which states that the drop in HCO3 and the drop in PCO2 must be equal to 1 over 1. So let's take a look at that. How much did our bicarb drop? Our bicarb dropped by 24 to 15. That's 9 points. Okay? How much did our PCO2 drop by, however? Our PCO2 did not drop at all. It's still at 40. How much should it have dropped? It should have dropped by a 9 points. Right? And the reason why is because Winter's formula would predict that if this were a metabolic acidosis that were occurring, the bicarb drop of 9 should mean the PCO2 drop should be 9, but it didn't drop low enough. So if the PCO2 did not drop low enough, there must be a respiratory acidosis because the PCO2 did not drop enough. So what we actually have here is we have an anion gap metabolic acidosis, we have a metabolic alkalosis, and we have a respiratory acidosis. So we have a triple acid-base disorder that we could figure out just based on the blood gas and also the Chem 7. Why don't you join me for part 8 for a couple more questions? Thanks.